His name is Angel Isaac Perez. We know him as Isaac or Ike or Ike.
IKIE.
As a kid, a little bit of sensitive about having the first name Angel because kids were a little mean and they'd pick on for having a girl's name. So when he was in South Carolina, he wasn't known as Angel. He's known by Isaac.
I called him Isaac.
I knew him as Isaac.
I called him Isaac.
However, when he went into the Army, they read off the paper and they're calling out names and they say, Perez, Angel, I. And all of his Army friends and Fayetteville family know him now as Angel.
I know him as Angel.
Angel.
And we also called him from high school days Al.
Al. Always Al.
Because he strikes a remarkable resemblance to the 80s R&B star Al B. Shore. Google it, you'll love it, it looks just like him. And one of his football coaches used to call him Al Perez, the Latin heartthrob, which was a wrestler, one of those WWF wrestlers back in the day. So Al kind of stuck with him for a long time.
Isaac, since he was a little boy, had that laugh.
That one?
That machine gun. Laugh.
It's very infectious. I mean, he'll just get everybody going.
It was very funny. You had to laugh whenever he laughed.
It was just corny. His laugh was just corny.
His laugh was ridiculous. That it was loud.
Well, that's the one thing that I remember most about Isaac. He had a great smile. His laugh was amazing.
You know, he has a big smile. He always had a big smile and his little teeny teeth that used to bug him.
He would tell these silly jokes and he would have this laugh.
It just brought the room, everybody in the room lighted up every time he would laugh.
In a whole room full of people.
It would just light up a room.
Like, he can walk into a room and just light it up.
You could hear him laugh.
Something like that. Before the joke gets out, it's just mired in that laugh. And so you're not laughing at the joke, you're laughing at this guy.
My godfather came to take me to the hospital and he was a cab driver in a limo. So here I was in a limo going to the hospital, and every time I got a pain, I wouldn't cry, I wouldn't freeze, I'd just go into a laughing hysteria. And everyone thought I was losing my mind, because even when I got to the hospital, and the labor pains were coming, and every time a labor pain would hit, I would just laugh and laugh and laugh. I always thought he was gonna be a lawyer. I mean, the kid had so many questions about everything. Till today, he loved music. And for me to calm him down, get him to take a nap, or just to take some him time, you know, some me time, it's your time. Relax for a little while. I put the earphones on him, I got pictures of him, and he would just sit there. The Peachy is his cousin. They're 5 months apart, but even though they're 5 months apart, Peachy was always a whole head taller than Isaac, or more. But Isaac loved to aggravate him with his laughter. If Peachy was stubbed his toe, Isaac would go into a laughing hysteria, and Peachy would just go into rage. Peachy can tell you more about that one, I'll tell you that.
Hey everyone, how you doing? As you can see, people from Brooklyn, we're in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, tonight in Loma. This is where we grew up and where IKIE grew up with us, you know, before he moved to South Carolina. And it's not a typical looking Brooklyn place. It's like pretty nice. Right here is where we grew up at, in this first floor apartment. And as you can see, there's gonna be pictures that I was gonna put up, and you're gonna see the same picture we used to take in front of the window, in front of the house as kids growing up. All right, my aunt Cecil Peters' mom got a picture of all of us actually in front of this house, all of us as kids, and Ike's out there with a pamper and nothing else in a Sunday suit, but the rest of us were all dressed up. But that's the fun we used to have in Brooklyn back then.
This is where that picture was taken when he was doing his little Buddhist thing, and he was getting his Zen together. You can see the little semblance of it. That's where it was at.
Oh man.
when we were kids growing up, back in my grandmother's house when we were kids, we'd all be just hanging out, making clubhouses out of sheets, towels, holding them against the wall. Just, my uncle would make us wrestle when we were kids. You know, it was just having fun, man.
He'd stand by her bassinet like a guard.
He was a fun brother. He taught me so much stuff as a kid. Taught me how to ride a bike. He taught me how to kick a football. He taught me how to play football.
When Zachary came along, mm-hmm. he was 8. So he was a little older. And he was a good brother.
He was a tough love brother, you know? It's kind of tough on you always, but always because he wanted what was best for you.
When Todd came into our lives, Zachary was 6 months old. Isaac was 8. Julie was 5.
I don't have any other children besides Isaac, Julie, and Zachary. And it's something I always wanted, and these kids were very special to me. I treated them, from the day we got together, I treated them as they were my own, and I still do, you know. They're my heart and my soul.
We met, he was a good guy, you know, I married him right away, and we moved away, and it was very, very hard on Isaac. Mostly Isaac.
He fought tooth and nail there for a while. Well, he fought the relationship tooth and nail for quite a while.
Isaac fought me tooth and nail. Oh, my.
I would say it took probably a good year before he settled down and said, you know, this isn't too bad. You know, he started making friends.
I met Isaac in about 1983, we're both military dependents, and our fathers got stationed in Charleston, South Carolina. We lived in the suburbs of Goose Creek and went to middle school there together. I like to tell people he was Facebook before there was Facebook. When we were kids, there wasn't any technology. You went outside and played. He would go collect the kids to go play. He would knock on my door, drag me out of the house, and then we'd get some more friends. And you know, we'd go to the youth center, go to the pool, bowling alley, we'd play football, but he was the catalyst, you know, behind all that.
I used to visit him down south in South Carolina. We used to do things we couldn't do up north, you know, play marbles and stuff. It was great.
I remember one time me and Ike were walking to school. I would go pick him up at his house, and then we'd walk the rest of the way to school. We'd cut through the woods, and for some reason, neither one of us felt like going to school. So I think we talked each other into playing hooky in the cutting class. And I remember we talked about it, and we were outside school in the woods looking at the school, and the final bell rang, and he's like, well, that's it, man, we're cutting school. And I remember trekking through the woods to the front of the school, and we didn't have any plan, we didn't know what we were gonna do. We had no excuse the next day why we were out of school. And I remember Ike loved movies. He memorized movies, and we were in the front of the school in the wood line, and he started talking about Beverly Hills Cop with Eddie Murphy, and he loved the part with the banana in the tailpipe. I'm not falling for the banana in the tailpipe. So somehow he or I concocted this plan. We were going to put pine cones in the tailpipe of one of our teachers, his favorite teacher, and we did like this low crawl across the road with, we had pine cones, and we're like 12, 13 years old, I guess, maybe even younger. And we started shoving pine cones in a tailpipe, not knowing what it was gonna do, but it was just, you know, he loved the joke, he loved the movie. And then one of the janitors or maintenance men, I guess, saw us and screamed at us. We ran back into the woods, and we had to trek through like 2 miles of woods to come out to the other side. And, you know, we had ticks and stuff on us. It was fun. It was like a, you know, Tom Sawyer, Huckleberry Finn moment for us. But, you know, we spent a whole day working hard to avoid work. But that was Isaac.
I just knew him in class. You know, we had a lot of classes together. He was good friends with Tim, who I was good friends with, and they always hung out together. You know, I'm here at Goose Creek, this is where I teach, and this is the same halls that we would be down, walk in the halls together, in classes together here.
We had a couple classes together, but you know, he always hung out with the jocks, but you know, I just knew him as a funny guy.
Isaac was a self-professed ladies' man.
We dated on and off for probably about 4 years, maybe even more. High school and just a little bit of college.
Played football, he was on the wrestling team.
Well, I remember he wrestled, so I helped Coach Covington sometimes with the wrestling team.
Isaac was very competitive. He always attended practice, very dedicated. He fit the mode of a wrestler, self-motivated, and he would come to practice and work hard and dedicate himself to having a good year. We had a really good team that year that he was with us. The 1989-90 squad was very talented.
He decided to go into the military.
Went in December of 91, and he was airborne infantry, the 82nd out of Fort Bragg.
He decided to become a boxer.
He didn't box a day in his life prior to going into the Army.
That threw me for a loop.
And the story goes is that the coaches there in Bragg would go to the different sections or divisions and ask if anybody had any boxing experience. And one of his friends told this story as memorial, said that when they came in and asked, Isaac's hand was the first one that went up when they said anybody had boxing experience.
The most nonviolent, peaceful person you ever want to meet with a hearty laugh, and he's a boxer.
He said that he didn't have any boxing experience, but he knew he didn't want to stay in infantry. So although his friend said that although he didn't have any, what he lacked in boxing skill, he made up for in heart.
We were both trying out for the Army boxing team, actually the Fort Bragg boxing team in Fort Bragg, North Carolina. And I made about as skin on my teeth as I'm thinking he did too. And they put us together in the same room in the barracks. We had a boxing barracks that was separate from the other soldiers. And we happened to be roommates. Boy, I didn't like it at first. You know, you want your own room as a young man, but you know, we worked it out together. We hit it off from the beginning.
He got it, man. Hey, Warren. Hey, Warren.
Personal skill, I had no doubt that he could get a really challenging job.
Reunion memories, it was just like seeing the old high school Isaac again, like nothing ever changed.
Always looking to see, I think Isaac it was, always to see what girl had improved, looked the hottest since last time.
He loved it. He loved saying, hey, did you see so-and-so?
We had to go to the bathroom, but Isaac didn't want to stop. So I used said empty beer cans to do that, all right? And lots of gay jokes were made about, you know, haha, look how small it is, etc. Just guy stuff, okay? But I rolled the window down because it was full and I still had to go. and I had to empty it, so I emptied it. And the wind carried it all back into the back seat. And you hear Tim and Clint just screaming and yelling, stop it, it's going. And I look back and it's like they had little sweat beads on them. And I'm like, you know, whatever, man, calm down. It's just urine. And so that was always a story that probably not the most appropriate, but it's PG. That's a story that always got brought up whenever we get together.
On a July 4th weekend, 2011, he was visiting me in Washington, D.C. Him and another great friend of ours, Raul, were there for the weekend. We went to a baseball game, Nationals Park. It was a beautiful day, gorgeous day. We're sitting in the stands, telling jokes, you know, and whenever we're around each other, you know, acting like teenagers again. And afterwards, we went to the National Harbor for some drinks. We met up with our girls. And midway through the night, he started feeling sick. So he went to a friend's house that was lived close by, and he had couldn't hold anything down. And in typical fashion, he blamed it on me. He said he got a hold of some bad ham in my refrigerator. And I told him that's what you get for eating all my food. And after that weekend, he went back to North Carolina. And a few weeks later, he still couldn't eat, couldn't hold anything down at all. And he said he'd lost 10, 15 pounds and he went to the doctor. He had called me a few weeks after that and said that they found a spot, is what he said. And, you know, what does that mean? You found a spot? And he said they think it's cancer.
He was diagnosed with gastric carcinoma, which is cancer of the stomach. He was diagnosed with gastric carcinoma in September of 2011.
And, you know, that's when you, not having personally been affected by that in my life to that point, fortunately, didn't know a lot about it, was ignorant to it, and doing some homework, when he said it was stomach cancer, when you read about that, it's not, it usually doesn't end well. It's, you know, 25% survival rate.
And then I got a call from Carrie, his fiance, I guess they were at the time, living there, and she was crying. And all she was saying that it's not good. And she went on to explain some medical things that I don't really remember. And I then, so that was how I found out. She told me.
Finally, I think, I remember the day. And Deja said, hey man, I know we haven't talked in a while, but I'm gonna just jump right into this. And I sat down, knew it didn't probably be good, and he told me Isaac had cancer. And I was actually getting ready to go to work. And it was a sobering moment. I sat down. I don't think we cried on the phone, but I'm sure we were both crying. And I remember I, on the way to work, stopped by and said, told Melissa. And I had to go to work like that, but it was tough. It was a tough phone call.
I found out, I believe it was my cousin that let me know.
I think it was Lila that told me. I think she called me and told me that he had the cancer.
My mom told me about his cancer.
He gave me a call. I'll never forget. I was in bed laying down with my wife, and he gave me a call. And he was letting me know what was going on. He said, hey, it is cancer. You know, I put my phone down, and I just started crying just right there. Just, my wife's like, what's wrong? I just cried. It's cancer.
And he called me. I asked me not to get upset. It's going to be fine. He's having surgery done. They're going to take it out and everything's going to be fine. It's like, all right, okay.
He never, even knowing all that stuff, he always was planning forward.
Isaac's always said, what's next? He was awesome.
Still going to college. He was, his job, his work, and I kept talking to him, saying, hey man, you got to, you know, look at this, read this stuff about your diet, do this, and you know. But he was, you know, focused on living.
Of course, anyone with a diagnosis, you go through a lot of different emotions, but with Angel, he just accepted what he had. He was very compliant with no matter what we asked him to do. He was here for his appointments on time, and he continued to work full time.
He continued to work while he was getting his treatment?
Yes.
Now see, I don't think I even knew that.
Yes, he was. And I would say, Angel, are you sure are you okay? You know, are you strong enough? Are you having side effects? He said, I'm fine.
He would, you know, come to work, he would leave, and we'll go down the hall, and he'd have his treatment, and then, you know, he would come back to work, and he'd work as long as he could work. Angel was positive throughout the whole thing, and even when he was out, it was just, you know, I'm coming back, I'll be back to work, all the way to the end. You know, he never gave up.
I didn't think about him passing when I was with him, no matter what he looked like. You thought about it when you left, and I had that drive home, you know, alone in the car for 2.5-3 hours. You had a lot of time to mull it over then and think that, was that the last time that I saw him? I never thought I'd be sitting here having to talk to you in this camera, because I didn't think that he was going to die.
My thoughts is he's going to be okay. Because I've, you know, not everybody gets taken from it. Even though I kiss them and I bathe them and he always reassured me, Ma, it's gonna be fine. Mom, it's gonna be all right, don't worry. And no matter how much I knew he was wrong, I wanted to believe him.
So when he said he was going to make it no matter what to the wedding, you know, I was ecstatic. So he flew in, little man flew in, you know, Carrie flew in, and they came to my school. We played football at recess with my students. He took half the kids, I took half the kids. It was just an awesome time. And then that night, all the guys at my wedding were playing basketball. So we're playing full-on basketball court, full-court basketball, and my buddy was playing against my brother. My team won, and if the team that wins stays on. So my brother's like, I'm gonna sit this one out. And he sat it out, and my buddy was giving him razzing him, saying, hey, what do you mean? I'm gonna take you out next time. Come on, come on, come on. He was like, nah, man, I'm gonna chill. I'm gonna sit this one out, you know? And he started looking at his fingers saying, you know, the chemo's starting to get to my, you know, my fingers. I'm not used to these, like, tingling. And my buddy's face just shook. He's like, you're going through chemotherapy and playing basketball? Like, so I went and surprised him, and my mom's like, you know, be ready, be ready, be ready. And when I walked in the hospital, you know, I surprised him, and my whole goal for that first 30 seconds was to not cry and not break down. So I gave him a hug, gave him a kiss. He was sleeping, and I said, hey, I'm here. Gave him a hug and a kiss. I said, hey, rest up, I'm gonna get some lunch. I just got in town. It was a cool way to escape. And then right when I left that room, kind of, you know, dropped to my knees, and the mom and my aunt had to hold me. It's, no one's prepared for that, you know? So when other people came later on, I tried to at least text a picture to say, you know, this is the same Isaac, except you gotta be prepared because it's not the same form of Isaac.
I didn't know how bad it was until I got to North Carolina. And my brother Zach picked me up and showed me pictures on how bad it was.
But before I went to see him prior to the hospital, and he's like, I'm gonna warn you. I've lost a lot of weight. So just, you know, be advised. That's, you know, you're gonna see me, and he's like, yeah, I look sick now.
That was surreal. Seeing Angel lose that weight. Now again, I'm used to seeing him cut weight and this and that in the boxing game, you know. But that's cutting weight, like, that's not cutting weight. That was scary for me.
We saw him, I had lost a little bit of the hope that he was going to pull through. You know, whenever we walked him around in the wheelchair and he needed a little help walking around and stuff like that, your hope started to fade a little bit.
Of course, I never thought he was going to die. You know, I never thought he would pass. I thought they would fix it. I mean, he's a young man.
I live alone. Whenever you had the time to go ahead and, you know, lay in bed and toss and turn and think about stuff at night, whenever your mind is idle, he didn't smoke, he didn't chew tobacco. I mean, hell, I treat my body like a freaking amusement park. I'm the one that should have got something like that.
Yeah, the whole experience, what, you know, cancer does to you was new for me, and the fact that it, you know, it was affecting best friend, you know, made it hard. You want to take that pain from him, but you can't.
What was that like for you as a mother when you saw his health and his condition deteriorate? What was it like?
It's funny that he's still, you know, you see all this outward appearance of him, but he's still him inside. When, you know, you put his gown on and he asked for a sock to cover his junk, his private area. He's still modest. He's still, you know, and it's funny, you know, growing up as kids in locker rooms and stuff, you know, you've seen it a dozen times, but it's, you know, it's little moments like that where, you know, it's really still him, you know. Like, what are you, you know, all the things you could be worried about, you're worried about that.
The decision to post his condition on Facebook, that was a challenge for you. Explain why, and what was that moment like to make that decision?
Yeah, I thought, you know, people need to know, in hindsight, great decision, but I don't think he felt comfortable with it. I think part of that was maybe denial, you know, right up until the end, or not wanting to. It's like when you tell them you need to do this, it's like you're giving up on them, or tell them that, you know, it's final, but You know, you don't want to say that to your friend. So I think, you know, the friends that were there, yourself, you know, selling it, I guess, to him in a good way that, you know, I think he got a lot out of it. He had a lot of love and support.
He visited my cousin at the hospital, Kate.
When the word got out, floods of love started coming in. There's kind of two feelings I had. There's definitely two feelings I had. One feeling was, you know, my brother was a loved man. I mean, to see people from all walks of life, from all over the land, flying, driving, doing everything they could just to be by his side and show some support was just absolutely amazing. On the other hand, what was scary for me was the fact that if it wasn't real, they wouldn't be coming in. So it kind of put a sense of reality, like, you know, enjoy your time with them, because, you know, we don't know how much time is left. And to know that was extremely scary.
That killed me that I couldn't be there for him. You know, what was really, really hard is that I couldn't talk to him. I would try to call him, and he wouldn't answer the phone. He didn't take my calls because he was pissed off about the divorce.
But even hearing that, you wanted to be there, though. You wanted to be
yes,
there.
Yes, I did. Yes, I did. I wanted to see my son. And that's, you know, me not going there, that's something I got to live with the rest of my life. You know, I could have went there and I could have barged in there and said, you know, here I am. I love you, IKIE, and all that stuff. I didn't want to go there and cause him any more pain than what he was going through.
They're all saints. The love that they showed my brother and my family, I can't even put it into words. I believe that his life was extended because that he felt at home there, and they took such good care of him that he probably wouldn't have been able to survive and fight as much if it wasn't for those team of doctors and nurses and co-workers and just the constant stream of love that they had came consistently and provided him. To see the very diverse group of people coming in, young, old, black, white, brown, green, yellow, orange. I mean, it was it looked like the world was coming together for my brother. And it was beautiful. So when I got down there the second time, and, you know, I was there when he's like, I have to call the school and withdraw from this class. I was like, how many classes you got left? And I was like, you know, just one is three credits. And then in talking with Carrie, she's like, yeah, he's partway through the last class. There's got to be something we can do as far as like an honorary degree. So she's like, you know, we should figure that out. And it literally the next day, I drove straight to Fayetteville State University. I was like, who's the chancellor? Who is, you know, who's the provost? Who can we talk to? The dean of students? Who can, you know, we got to make this happen. And by chance, as I was leaving, because no one is able to talk to me, I walked through the parking lot. I saw someone that looked like a chancellor, and it was the chancellor of the school. And he's like, walk with me to my office. And I told him the whole story about my brother persevering through chemo, full-time job, you know, still going to school, doing everything he could for the last, you know, 6 months or whatnot, that he's got one class left. Is there anything we can do for him? And they said, you know, he made a couple phone calls to the dean of the business school, and everyone knew Angel Perez.
I received a call from his brother, if I'm not mistaken. Informed us that he's at Cape Fear. And he asked whether we could give him the diploma. He was short of only one course, but he had taken an additional elective course, so he had already met the requirements for graduation for all practical purposes. That's why they will review his credential and look at his transcript and notice that he has basically meet the requirements. By that I mean he has had a minimum of 36 credit hours. And that is the minimum requirements to obtain the degree.
They said, please don't give this to him. We want to come down to the hospital and give it to him. And we're not just going to have you just give it to him. He earned this degree. This is exactly what Fayetteville State University is about, persevering, showing triumph, and really, it was the Bronco way, they said.
All of us, the chancellor, the provost, and myself, and other folks who knew him, were really, truly saddened. So that was the only way that we can express our sense of sorrow in a way, and recognize his accomplishments at Fayetteville State.
So, literally, they ended up showing up at the hospital. Isaac working at the hospital, we had like one of the rooms that they had.
Oh, that was amazing. Because I had him on the hallway. And you know, I'm mom, so mom gets the grief. Mom gets the brunt. And he's like, well, why are we over here? Why are we gotta be over here? Where's Zachary?
Wheelchaired him down there. He's like, where am I going? It's like a surprise. He's like, well, you know, surprises, you know, him being stubborn as always. And when we rolled him down, and literally every person that he knew from the college was there, it was a magical moment.
Degree, a master's of business administration. And any man with a Yankees t-shirt on. My team. Okay, I'm giving him a master's, and he's got the Yankees t-shirt.
Hold it up, buddy.
Good job, bud.
Also, watch you. It's one of our nice gold-plated FSU folders.
Nice.
I'm gonna pin you. FSU pin.
Volunteered to do that.
I may forget to put the back on.
There you go.
All right. Yay. Woo. Congratulations, team.
Happy words to your fan club.
Boy, I mean, you guys have heard the last speeches from me over the last 7 or 8 months. But first off, I like that tie.
How'd you get this degree from a true superhero?
This has been something that I've been starting for since 2008, and I can't lie. I thought it was something that had gone by me. I wasn't gonna be able to achieve it when I got sick, and I don't know how many people have heard me say. One more class, and that was it. That's all I could say. And I want to thank everybody here. I want to thank Dr. Tampoli. I want to thank all the heads of the Fayetteville State Business Program. Thank you all for allowing me to graduate and get this. Prestigious award, degree, and just my heart goes out. It's a heartfelt thank you. I mean, I can't say enough. You know, no matter what happens, this is something that this is just something that I will always, always treasure. You all know that. Those of you that have seen me here day in and day out, you know I'll treasure it. And that's it. Thank you. Well, thank you very much.
That was so beautiful. He was so proud. And believe it or not, I don't know if you could see on the video that they took, they came in small groups, you know, to express their congratulations and such. And everyone that come in, please have a cupcake, have something to drink, have a snack. I mean, he never, you know, did this, and he just stood up and, yes, please have a cupcake. And it was, okay, we'll take a cupcake, you know. It was still Ike. Three days before he passed, he had a talk with his doctor. And it was like he was sitting in his wheelchair. I was sitting next to him, and the doctor was standing, and I don't remember, Carrie, maybe her mother. I don't remember. And Isaac sat up in his chair, and he looks at the doctor, as a matter of factly, and says, "So what's the next step? Well, what are we gonna do now?" And the doctor, his shoulders dropped a little, and a look of sorrow came over his face. And he says, "Well, we're gonna send you home Friday. You can go home." Oh, Isaac says, "Finally." Oh, I was waiting for that. And he says, "Yeah, but we first have to get your bed in the house. We have to get everything situated, so you won't be able to leave till Friday." And he says, "Friday? All right. All right. So we'll go on Friday. I mean, just no big deal." And he says, but then what? Because by this time they were feeding him through the bag, and they were giving him insulin. Keep the infection, make sure keep it down. And the doctor came around and sat. Scooted over, sat here. Ike, and he puts his arm on Isaac, and he puts his arm on me and says, "We're just gonna keep you comfortable, because never dropped his shoulders, Ike. Never. He never dropped his shoulders. He never slumped. He just said, "Okay. All right. Thank you. Don't worry," he says to the doctor.
I told him, I said, "I love you." I said, "You have to know that." And, you know, his mom was, she had this pump, you know, trying to get oxygen into his lungs. And and, you know, because he was laboring to breathe. It was really a labor. And it just stopped.
Lauren had called me at work and said that, you know, she got a message that it wasn't looking good, that if I wanted to go, I might, you know, go see. I might need to go now. So I said, okay, I was at work, so we'll talk about it. Try to work out some arrangements, and I left 30 minutes to go to another building, and I was about to teach a leadership class, and had just silenced my phone, and before I did, I looked at it, and I saw I had two missed calls, one from my wife that I just talked to, and then another one from Larry Spann. So I thought, well, you know, those being too close, you know, calling me, and a few times, a few missed calls, I kind of got a feeling that was too late. So I kind of put that to the side. I couldn't talk to anybody at that time. I didn't want to do that at work. And I taught that class. That was hard. So you kind of push it out of your mind. But then I went home. And you know, it was just a long, quiet night.
So whenever I got the call, you know, it's just like what you would think it would be. It was, you know, you cry. For it to be 2 years and for me to be a little bit on the, like, I feel my little shit trembling and stuff like that, excuse me. I think that pretty much says it right there. He could have been no closer of a friend to me had he been my own blood, my family, my dad, my mom. I mean, you still, when you think about it, yeah, it broke me for a little while. I didn't talk to anybody. I didn't want, that was the way that some people, you know, all over social media, which is fantastic, that's the way that they deal with it. I didn't talk to anybody. I don't want consoling. I didn't want consoling. I wanted to be alone. I wanted to be mad. I wanted to be sad on my own.
Hearing that someone our age and young, because I still feel young, I mean, even though I've been teaching here almost 20 years, it kind of catches you.
You have somebody who's the same age as you, where, you know, I feel like I still have a whole lifetime ahead of myself. And when you find out that somebody that you've known since you were an early teen has passed away from something that they kind of had no control over, it kind of puts your life in perspective, because you think about all of the things, at least I think about all of the things that I still want to do in my life, and I realize that somebody who has the same amount of years on the earth as me is gone.
It's just another a sad time of a young man passing early. As coaches, we're really not supposed to outlive our players.
We all want the best for each other, and we all want the best for our patients, but sometimes that comes in the form of death. And it's harder for us living here than knowing that a loved one had passed. And so it was hard. But he had a wonderful, wonderful memorial here at the hospital that celebrated his whole life. So it just wasn't about the cancer, because that was a piece of his life. But the majority of his life was from the time he was born and how he lived his life. So I got to meet family members, I got to meet friends, I got to see videos of the angel I never knew before, because I only knew him basically when he was diagnosed. So he had a whole life before that, and that was a celebration of his life.
He was 39 years old, it makes me think about it makes me think about my life, my family's life, you know, every day.
What Isaac meant to me was life. Isaac lived the life, and I think through his passing, I learned to live the life. take a chance more to just don't wait for it, go get it.
Isaac had a lot to do with teaching me about relationships. I think that he prepared me for life, for my marriage and for friendships and for relationships in general.
Kind of like a wake-up call to kind of not take days for granted. And I still, there are times I think about him quite frequently.
Well, I mean, you know, ever since we were kids, you know, the kid's a scrapper, man. He was always a fighter, always, you know, used to always get hurt, but he'd always come back at you, you know? So that's, I mean, if anything I learned from him in life is, you know, just keep going, man, just keep fighting.
To me, it's, it really hasn't, I guess I haven't really dealt with it. I still try not to. It's hard, because there'll be days where I can feel him with me.
I still talk to him. I talked to him the other day whenever we watched that game together. I sat right there, got drunk by myself, and yelled at the television. I had to work that night, so I went ahead and I taped it. Didn't let anybody go ahead and tell me. He and I sat there, and he was the little angel on the shoulder.
I talk to IKIE every day.
I often think about him. Because as I said, he was just so dear to me. With his smiling face.
So. And I'll just start crying out of the blue. I don't.
So you're still, in some ways, you're still grieving your brother's death?
I am. I am not really let it out.
It made me think about my life and put it in perspective where, you know, we're all mortal.
We all have an expiration date. We all, you know.
I learned something through Angel. You know, I tell my children, you know, the people that you're friends with 5 years after high school, you know, everybody's going to go their own way. You know, you're not even going to know these people 5 years from then. Well, he made a mockery of that statement. And I've heard it said by many others, and I was one who beat that. He let me into his world. I got really close to his family. And really, it just made me look closer at the people around me and just to say, hey, you know, I love you. You know, just tell you, you know. It's just out of the blue, hey, look, you know, you mean something to me. You know, your existence, your presence in my life matters.
Nobody's going to remember Isaac for the end, the way that he looked in the hospital. That's a sickness right there. Nobody remembers. When you think of Isaac, you think of a room full of people and that laugh from the other side, and you know that's him.
We thought it was important to get together, you know, to celebrate my brother's birthday, mainly because, you know, his life and legacy still does go on, and we think about him just as if it was, as if he was here with us in the physical form. And it was pretty special because it gave us a chance to dedicate the day to him and be thinking about fun times, crazy times, embarrassing times, and overall just give him the day. And we'll continue that as long as we can, whether we're near or far, but definitely that day is a holiday in our family. When it's all said and done, and people look back on Angel Isaac Perez's life and his body of work and the people that he has impacted, there was definitely a gentleman who loved life, loved his family, was always, he was tough on people, but it was because he wanted the best for them, the best for his family, the best for everyone around him. So he's always trying to improve the people around him. And when you look back at his story and his fight and continuing to work, continuing to try to be the best father he could be, and continuing to try to beat cancer, it just seemed like this constant fight for life. And if anything we could take from that is we have it here. You know, if you're watching this or if you're standing on God's green earth today, you have that chance to fight. And how are we doing? How are we affecting others, or not? Or how are we making today worth it.
When I ask why, it hurts my heart too much. I cannot be angry at the Lord because He gave him to me for so long. To be the mother that I so enjoy being, you know. But I can't be angry at anyone. And why? So that's why I can't ask why. I can't ask why. You know, I used to sit and watch other people go through this, you know. And I would say, oh my God, I'd die. I don't know how. But going through it, you don't. You just take one day at a time and thank the Lord for what you do have. And know that He's in His hands. That is comforting to me. I want them to remember His strength, His love of life, oh, and His saying that He used to say to me all the time, Ma, you always surround yourself with good people, with people that with positive attitudes, because when you surround yourself with goodness, goodness comes to you. And I will always, always live by that.